In the blistering heat of a California summer, a family's darkest secrets came to light in the most tragic way possible. Lisa Mathers, a seemingly ordinary housewife, made a choice that would set off a deadly chain of events, leading to the unraveling of her family and a murder that would shock an entire community. This is the story of betrayal, deception, and a deadly affair that left two young children fighting for their lives, and a husband caught in the crosshairs of revenge. Lisa Mathers, a 34-year-old housewife, appeared to live an idyllic life. She resided in a modest home with her husband, Danielle, and their two children, Tyler, who was 4, and Emma, only 2. From the outside, their lives seemed normal. Daniel, a hardworking construction manager, spent long hours on job sites to provide for his family, often leaving early in the morning and returning late at night. His dedication to work was unwavering, and while his long hours provided financial stability, they also left Lisa to manage the home alone. Lisa Mathers grew up in a small town not far from Bakersfield, California. Her early life had been one of simplicity, but it wasn't without its struggles. Born into a family of modest means, Lisa was the youngest of 3 children. Her father worked long hours as a truck driver, often gone for days at a time, leaving her mother to care for the household. Her mother, a strict woman who believed in discipline and order, ran their home like a tight ship. For most of her childhood, Lisa felt overshadowed by her older siblings, who seemed to excel in everything. While her sister was a star athlete and her brother the academic pride of the family, Lisa often felt like she never quite measured up. From a young age, Lisa dreamed of escape. She wanted to break free from the small town life that seemed to offer her nothing but limitations. She longed for adventure, for romance, and for the kind of life she saw in the movies, full of excitement and passion. But life had other plans. At 19, she met Daniel Mathers, a hard-working young man from the same town. He was kind and dependable, but their relationship wasn't the whirlwind romance Lisa had once imagined. Still, he offered her stability, and after only a year of dating, they married. In the beginning, their marriage was simple and comfortable. Daniel, a construction manager, worked long hours to provide for them, while Lisa stayed at home, taking care of the house. She found herself slipping into the role of a housewife easily enough, but deep down, something was missing. As the years went on, the routine of their lives began to weigh on her. There were no grand adventures. No sparks of passion, just day after day of the same tasks. By the time their first child, Tyler, was born in 2004, Lisa felt a growing sense of restlessness, though she buried it beneath her duties as a mother. Tyler's arrival had brought joy, but also more responsibilities. Daniel's work hours only increased, leaving Lisa to take care of their son alone. The isolation of motherhood began to wear on her. Daniel was a good man, but he was often absent, both physically and emotionally. He would come home exhausted, falling into bed without much conversation. Lisa craved more than this, a life that felt alive, where she wasn't just someone's wife or someone's mother. In 2006, Emma was born. And though Lisa loved her children, she couldn't shake the feeling that she was losing herself. The monotony of daily life, changing diapers, cooking meals, cleaning the house, began to feel suffocating. Daniel remained focused on his work, often telling Lisa that it was all for their future, for the life they were building. But Lisa couldn't see that life anymore. She felt invisible, like a ghost moving through the motions of her existence. It was in the summer of 2007 that Lisa's life took a turn. One day, she met Ryan Carter, a mechanic at a local garage. Her car had broken down, and Ryan had been the one to fix it. What began as a casual conversation quickly turned into something more. Ryan was different from Daniel in every way. He was attentive, charming, and he seemed to understand the frustrations Lisa had been carrying for years. Their talks became frequent, and soon Lisa found herself driving to the garage more often than necessary, seeking out the attention that Ryan so easily gave her. Ryan wasn't just a mechanic to Lisa. He represented the excitement she had longed for. He made her feel seen in a way she hadn't felt since she was a young girl with dreams of adventure. Over time, what started as an innocent connection turned into an affair. By the end of 2007, Lisa and Ryan were meeting in secret at motels on the outskirts of Bakersfield. These encounters became the highlight of Lisa's days, a brief escape from the life she had grown to resent. But with the affair came guilt. Lisa knew she was betraying Daniel, a man who had only ever tried to provide for their family. She was also failing her children, as she became more distant from them, spending more time planning her secret meetings with Ryan than caring for Tyler and Emma. The guilt gnawed at her, but she couldn't pull herself away from Ryan. He had become her escape, her outlet, from the emptiness that had taken over her life. By July of 2008, the affair had been going on for nearly a year. Lisa's relationship with Daniel had deteriorated even further. He remained oblivious to the affair, but he could sense that something was wrong. Lisa was no longer the same woman he had married. She was often distracted, distant, and their conversations became brief exchanges about household matters, nothing more. Lisa, on the other hand, was consumed with keeping her secret. Her life had become a careful balancing act, hiding the affair from her husband and her children, while still trying to maintain the facade of a happy family. On that fateful afternoon of July 17th, 2008, Lisa Mathers had no idea that her life was about to change forever. Her excitement to meet Ryan consumed her every thought. The past few months had been filled with the thrill of sneaking away to spend time with him, away from the stresses of her home life. For Lisa, these moments of escape felt like the only time she could truly breathe. But this afternoon was different. In her rush to meet Ryan at their usual spot, the small run-down motel on the outskirts of Bakersfield, Lisa hurriedly loaded Tyler and Emma into her SUV. It was already well past noon, and the sun had been scorching for hours. The temperature that day had peaked at over 100 degrees, but Lisa didn't pay attention to the heat or the discomfort of her children as they squirmed in their car seats. Her mind was elsewhere. She was focused on getting to Ryan, craving the brief moments of freedom and excitement he offered. As she pulled into the motel parking lot just before 2 o'clock p.m., Lisa hastily parked the SUV, leaving the windows rolled up and the air conditioner off. She didn't stop to think about how the heat would intensify inside the vehicle. All that mattered in that moment was getting inside to see Ryan. As Lisa and Ryan spent the next few hours together inside the motel room, the heat inside the SUV continued to climb. Tyler, just 4 years old, was the first to show signs of distress. His small body couldn't handle the extreme temperature, and soon he was drenched in sweat. Emma, only two, followed shortly after, struggling to breathe in the suffocating heat. Their cries and movements slowed as their bodies grew weaker, succumbing to heat exhaustion. But Lisa, lost in her secret life, was completely unaware of what was happening just outside the motel walls. By the time Lisa finally left the motel, around 4 p.m., the damage had already been done. She was still distracted as she walked toward the car. But before she reached it, a passerby, Susan Blake, noticed something was terribly wrong. Susan had been walking through the parking lot when she spotted Tyler and Emma motionless in the back seat. The heat was unbearable, even outside, and it was clear that the children inside were in danger. Without hesitation, Susan called 911. The paramedics arrived just in time to save the children's lives. They rushed Tyler and Emma to the hospital, where they were immediately treated for heat exhaustion. It was a miracle that they had survived, but their condition remained serious as doctors worked to stabilize them. Lisa, realizing the severity of what had happened, felt a deep sense of guilt, but her thoughts were still clouded by the fear of her affair being exposed. At the hospital, as part of the routine care process, doctors ran tests on both children to ensure there were no long-term complications from the heat. Among those tests was a DNA test, standard procedure for determining possible treatment options. But this simple test would soon unravel the life Lisa had tried so desperately to keep intact. When Daniel arrived at the hospital later that evening, he was distraught. His focus was on his children, terrified that he might lose them. But it wasn't long before the doctors approached him with unexpected news. Tyler and Emma were not biologically his. The revelation hit Daniel like a freight train. Everything he thought he knew about his family, his children, and his marriage was a lie. He demanded answers from Lisa, but she remained silent. She couldn't bring herself to admit the full extent of her betrayal. The next few days were filled with tension. Lisa barely spoke to Daniel, trying to figure out how to salvage the situation, but it was too late. On July 20th, 2008, Daniel had reached his breaking point. He confronted Lisa about the affair, about the children, and about the years of deception. His anger and hurt were overwhelming. And during the confrontation, he threatened her. In his rage, Daniel told Lisa that he would kill her for what she had done, for destroying their family. Lisa was terrified. She knew Daniel's temper and feared that he would follow through on his threats. That night, as she sat alone in their bedroom, her mind raced with thoughts of what to do next. She felt trapped. The guilt of her affair, the fear of Daniel's anger, and the shame of what had happened to her children weighed heavily on her. She believed that the only way to protect herself was to act first. On July 22nd, Lisa made a decision that would seal her fate. She couldn't shake the fear of what Daniel might do to her, so she planned to kill him before he had the chance to kill her. That evening, she waited until Daniel was alone in the kitchen before she made her move. With a knife in hand, she crept toward him, her mind clouded with desperation. As soon as Lisa confronted Daniel, a struggle ensued. Her heart raced as she raised the knife, but Daniel, stronger and fueled by his own anger, quickly overpowered her. The struggle was brief, but intense. In the chaos, Daniel wrestled the knife from her hands. In a moment of panic, Daniel turned the knife on Lisa. The blade struck deep, and in that instant, the life they had built together, however flawed, was shattered. Lisa collapsed to the kitchen floor, her blood pooling beneath her. The room that had once been filled with the sounds of family meals and laughter was now silent, except for the steady drip of blood hitting the cold tile. Daniel stood there, staring at what he had done, his hands trembling as he realized the weight of his actions. It was over. When the police arrived later that night, Daniel was arrested for Lisa's murder. But the investigation would reveal the full story. The years of betrayal, the affair, the threats, and Lisa's desperate attempt to kill Daniel first. As the evidence unfolds, it will become clear that Daniel had acted in self-defense. The night of July 22, 2008 would become one of the most unforgettable nights in the quiet Bakersfield neighborhood where the Mathers family lived. The streets were calm, as they usually were in the evenings, but the peace was shattered by a sudden scream, piercing the stillness. Neighbors, startled by the sound, rushed to their windows trying to make sense of the noise. Some gathered outside, sensing that something terrible had happened. Lights flickered on across the street, and whispers of worry spread through the neighborhood. Inside the Mathers home, Daniel stood frozen in the kitchen, his hands trembling, covered in blood. He stared at Lisa's lifeless body, sprawled on the floor, surrounded by a growing pool of red. The knife that had ended her life lay beside her, a silent witness to the violent struggle that had just taken place. Daniel's heart pounded in his chest, the weight of what had just happened sinking in. He had killed his wife in the heat of the moment, but the truth was far more complicated than the bloody scene might suggest. The neighbors, unable to ignore the eerie silence that followed the scream, called the police. When officers arrived, they found Daniel standing over Lisa, his clothes soaked in blood, still in shock. Without hesitation, they arrested him, charging him with her murder. Lisa's body was taken away, and the once lively Mathers home became a crime scene, filled with investigators trying to piece together what had led to such a horrific end. On July 24, 2008, the investigation began in full. Detectives took a deep dive into the Mathers' lives, and it didn't take long for the secrets to begin surfacing. They found phone records showing heated exchanges between Daniel and Lisa in the days leading up to her death. The threats Daniel had made over the phone were clear. A reaction to the discovery that Tyler and Emma, the children he had raised as his own, were not his biological children. These threats, combined with Lisa's actions on the night of her death, painted a grim picture of a marriage that had been falling apart for months. It became apparent that Lisa had been planning to kill Daniel. As the detectives sifted through the evidence, they uncovered Lisa's affair with Ryan Carter. Neighbors reported seeing Lisa meeting Ryan in secret over the past year, and Ryan himself was brought in for questioning. He confirmed the affair, admitting that Lisa had grown desperate in the days before her death, terrified that Daniel would follow through on his threats to kill her. The affair had unraveled the family, pushing Lisa to a point of no return, where she believed the only way to protect herself was to eliminate Daniel first. By August 5th, the detectives had gathered enough evidence to suggest that Lisa's death was not a simple case of domestic violence, but rather the culmination of months of betrayal, infidelity, and growing desperation. Lisa had armed herself with a knife, fully intending to kill Daniel, but in the chaos of the confrontation, Daniel had acted in self-defense. The affair, the threats, and Lisa's premeditated attempt to murder her husband all pointed to a far more complex story than what the bloody scene alone could reveal. As the investigation unfolded, Daniel's legal team quickly seized on the details. They presented Lisa as a woman driven to dangerous extremes by her affair and her fear of Daniel's discovery. The defense began to build a case that would portray Daniel not as a violent man, but as a husband pushed to the edge by betrayal, left with no choice but to defend himself when Lisa came at him with a knife. The trial began on October 14, 2008, and it captivated the entire community of Bakersfield. For weeks, the media had been covering the shocking details of Lisa's affair and the tragic death that followed. And now, the courtroom was packed with spectators eager to see how it would all unfold. The prosecution painted Daniel as a man consumed by rage and jealousy. They argued that his discovery of the affair, combined with the revelation that the children weren't his, had driven him to murder Lisa in cold blood. They presented the phone records as evidence of his intent, pointing to the threats he had made in the days leading up to her death. But the defense countered with a different story. They focused on Lisa's affair with Ryan, her neglect of the children, and her decision to arm herself with a knife on the night of her death. The defense argued that Lisa had been the aggressor, driven by fear and desperation after Daniel threatened her. They presented evidence showing that Lisa had planned to kill Daniel first, using the confrontation as a way to escape the life she had come to despise. Daniel, they argued, had acted purely in self-defense, reacting in the heat of the moment when Lisa attacked him. Throughout the trial, the tension in the courtroom was palpable. Daniel sat quietly as the events of his life were laid bare for everyone to see, his fate hanging in the balance. The affair, the betrayal, and the violence that followed had left his life in ruins. But now, the question was whether the jury would believe that he had killed Lisa in self-defense, or if they would convict him of murder. On November 18, 2008, after a month of emotional testimonies and evidence, the jury delivered their verdict. They found Daniel not guilty of murder, citing self-defense as the reason for Lisa's death. The courtroom fell silent as the words were read aloud, and the weight of the decision settled over everyone present. The verdict left the community of Bakersfield deeply divided. Some believed that Daniel had been a victim, a man pushed to his breaking point by his wife's infidelity and deceit. They saw the affair as the root cause of everything that had happened, and they sympathized with the anguish he must have felt upon learning that the children he loved were not his own. Others, however, condemned the outcome, seeing the violent end to Lisa's life as a tragedy that should have been avoided. To them, the affair didn't justify the killing, no matter how it had unfolded. In the end, Daniel was free, but the life he had known was destroyed. The Mathers home, once a place of family gatherings and shared meals, now stood as a haunting reminder of the dark secrets that had torn the family apart. The affair, the lies, and the violent death that followed would linger in the memories of those who had watched the trial unfold, leaving an indelible mark on the community. Daniel was left to pick up the pieces of his shattered life. Tyler and Emma, though still young, would grow up without their mother. The case left a dark cloud over the quiet Bakersfield suburb, serving as a grim reminder of how quickly secrets and lies can spiral into tragedy. And this leaves us to wonder, what would have happened if Lisa had never left the children in the car? What dark thoughts drove Daniel to the breaking point? We have so many cases of women being horrible mothers. And wives, like the case where a wife's affair with her husband's grandfather ends in murder. I know you're probably wondering, not even the father? She stepped two generations back and it's insane. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and check out that insane case.